Welcome to the Evelyn Y. Davis Studios at the National Press Foundation. We're talking today about the Congressional Budget Office. Part of its job is to tell Congress how much the big items of proposed legislation are going to cost. How do they figure that out? We'll find out right now. The National Press Foundation is a nonprofit dedicated to helping journalists cover complex topics with depth and accuracy. Our mission includes journalists around the U.S. and around the world. Welcome back. I'm Linda Topping-Streitfeld, Director of Training and Content at the National Press Foundation. Joining me in the Evelyn Y. Davis Studios is Sandy Davis, former Associate Director for Legislative Affairs at the Congressional Budget Office. Mr. Davis had that job from 2003 until this July when he retired from the federal government. Sandy Davis, welcome.
Thank you, Linda. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome. I'm glad you're here. I want to establish your bona fides a little bit. Mm-hmm. You actually started at CBO in 1996.
Yes.
And for the last dozen years or so, you were the principal liaison to Congress.
Right.
Can you describe that job?
Well, you know, it's for those in the D.C. area, there's a lot of congressional liaisons, obviously, agencies around town, trade associations. It is a different job, I think, than any of those, because in this particular job, I was sort of charged with helping to ensure that all our communications with the Hill were even-handed, that both sides got the information that we were putting out. It was more just a liaison and communication to ensure that everything was understood clearly. Most other congressional liaison jobs are sort of they funnel all the information from, say, the Hill, and they pass it out to their own folks, either in their agencies or elsewhere. At CBO, everybody is supposed to have ongoing communications with the people they're working for on the Hill, preparing cost estimates, doing analyses and other studies. And so I wasn't controlling all of that. I was just helping folks to ensure and keep in mind how we communicate with our Hill friends. So that's the nuts and bolts of the job.
Always in a completely nonpartisan
in a
way.
That was one of, you know, I think they probably got sick of me saying, okay, have we talked to the minority? We talked to the other side. So
right.
Yes, always
right.
To make sure everybody was aware of that. And then they really, to their credit, they always are.
Who's the toughest member of Congress you ever worked with?
Well, you know, I'm going to keep my old CBO hat on for just a little longer
and
not reveal.
Now.
I know, but you know, one of the things is we, and if I lapse into we, you'll have to understand that's, you know,
I know it's
old
been
habits
a lot
of die
years.
Hard. But at CBO, those communications are, you know, they're confidential, and they should be, those communications with member offices and the issues that are discussed. But I will say that I think the things that the types of members, the generic group of folks who may have gotten the most annoyed were those who sort of we had to push off, who we couldn't do the work for them that they wanted to have done, either in a timely enough way or at all, because we the demand for CBO analyses is so heavy. And we and at CBO, you have to give priority to the work of the committees under the Budget Act, and realistically to the leadership who's setting the sort of the overall legislative agenda. There's more work than we could ever do. So saying no to a lot of these other members, let's just say that members are not used to people telling them no. So I think that gets a little difficult.
Right. You mentioned the demand for the work is very heavy. How large is CBO?
So CBO has been actually fairly stable in its size over time. It's about 230, 235, something like that. There have been bump ups and reductions to some extent, but it's about that. You know, I'd say about 160 to 170 of those folks are the actual analysts doing the cost estimates, analyses, economic projections, things of this nature.
Mm-hmm.
So fairly stable.
So it's very numbers oriented, obviously.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's its mission.
Yes.
Is everybody walking around with a slide rule? What's the culture? Are these all number crunchers?
Well, if we didn't have spreadsheets, I'd say they'd be walking around with a slide rule. But they've all got spreadsheets, and there's everyone has the capacity to model. Yes, they're number crunchers, but not in the sense you might think. I mean, I'd say the majority of the folks there, well, everyone there has a strong economics background. And the type of work that you do as an economist is perfectly suited for CBO because you look at trade-offs and you think about trade-offs for different policy actions. So that economics training is key. We have a lot of PhD economists, particularly in the economics division. and in the other divisions that do broad studies. But folks who don't have that as a specific degree field, they have graduate degrees typically in public policy fields. They're all trained as analysts coming out of school or in their previous work experiences. And so CBO is also just very careful to make sure the folks coming in have an analytical focus in how they look at things, not sort of a policy advocacy focus in how they look at things. So yes, they're all adept in all the quantitative skills. I was one of the outliers. I was not so much. I was the word guy in the job that I had before, and of course in working as a liaison. But they are all highly skilled quantitatively, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So I know you brought some slides with you.
Yes, I did.
Let's take a look.
Okay, very good. So yes, this was actually a pretty big year for CBO. I'm going to give you a little bit of budget history, not too much, although history is one of my loves. But this was a pretty big year for CBO. CBO celebrated its 40th anniversary. Its first director, Alice Rivlin, was appointed in February of 1975. To celebrate that, we had a big event at CBO. We called in all the former directors, and they all sat there on a panel and discussed their experiences. And it reminded me of the important and significant things that have happened in federal budget and policymaking over the past 40 years that CBO has been a big part of. And it started off from the very beginning with drama with CBO, because I think you could fairly say that CBO was born in an era of reform. At the time of CBO's founding in 1975, this was actually the end of a period of very intense conflict between then President Nixon and the Congress over a range of issues. Remember, none of us can forget Watergate. There were a range of constitutional issues over which they battled. And one of those was battling over budget priorities. President Nixon had asserted that Congress, because of its outdated, outmoded procedures for setting budget decisions, wasn't capable of controlling spending and deficits. So the president took it upon himself to withhold funds that had been appropriated by law. Oddly enough, in line with his own budgetary priorities. So that got Congress's attention in a hurry. Those individual impoundments were challenged in court and overturned. But it did raise an important question for Congress about the capacity of its current budget process and whether it had a capacity to set overall budgetary priorities and to follow through with them in a comprehensive and orderly way. So after a couple of years of study and debate, of course Congress is always going to study and have commissions and things of this nature, so after a couple of years of study and debate, they actually produced a landmark measure, the Congressional Budget Act of 1974, formerly the Congressional Budget and Impoundment Control Act of 1974. And that law established a new budget process for the Congress, centered on the adoption of an annual budget resolution, which we could spend all day talking about, but we won't, to give Congress the capacity to set its own budget plan. But significantly for our discussion today, it also set up a new infrastructure for congressional budgeting. It established House and Senate budget committees that would be in charge of this new process. And it created the Congressional Budget Office to provide the information and analysis that in an independent manner that Congress would need to actually carry forward this process in a successful way. Now, so the two fundamental purposes of this law were really to help Congress restore its power of the purse and to enhance its credibility, enhance its capacity to budget. Mm-hmm. And CBO would help with this by just providing a sound, reliable source of information and analysis to do both things. To challenge the president and the administration on the policy claims whoever the president was, that they were making, and then also just to have a more sound basis for making the judgments that Congress had to make. But in setting up the CBO, it was clear that the CBO was set up to be, under the statute, to be independent. But it is one thing to say that CBO is going to be an independent entity, an independent agency. Mm-hmm. Another thing entirely to make it happen. So Alice Rivlin, the first director, had a difficult job that she realized was going to be difficult right off the bat. How do I make sure that CBO is independent from Congress and not subservient to Congress? CBO had to work for Congress. That was its client. The budget committees were its principal clients on the Hill above all others. But CBO was going to have to also maintain its independence, to really be, to maintain its nonpartisan role, and also to be effective for all members and not seen as sort of in league with one party, one house, one committee, or the other. There were really and she fought many battles on this, but she set the tone early. And I think there were a couple of examples from the early days of CBO, both involving Alice and then her successor, that I think really made it clear to people that CBO was going to be an independent institution and would not be treated in a political manner, would not be politicized.
Please share.
And so this first thing was really when CBO was asked to do an analysis of the Carter Energy Plan. So I'm old enough to remember the gas lines in the 70s, and the Arab oil embargo, and everything that was going on at the time. And
I'm old enough to remember the 55-mile-an-hour national speed limit.
As am I. And so the president's, one of the president's, President Carter's signature proposals was his new energy plan that was going to enhance energy security, cut back on energy consumption, promote energy development, these kinds of things. CBO was asked to do an analysis. CBO's analysis was not nearly so favorable and called into question many of the assumptions and the assertions that the president and the administration was making. Now picture this, you've got Alice and head of a new agency, but the Congress is now completely Democratic. And I guess you could say the mean old Richard Nixon is now gone. His successor, Gerald Ford, also Republican, now gone. Jimmy Carter's elected. So one party's in control of everything. And the signature legislative agenda item is now before the Congress. And here's this little brand new agency, CBO, a negative voice.
You would have thought the skids would be greased and that would fly right through.
And I'm sure that's what many members of Congress may have thought. But Alice made sure that they understood CBO was going to be a different animal and that they created an independent agency. This is what they've got. And she had to stand firm with that. And I'm sure there were difficult moments in committee hearings, and also not just the nature of the analysis, but how it was released, that CBO released it independently without clearing it with any congressional committee, anything like that.
Right.
So that was a signature moment for CBO. Then another signature moment for me was when, you know, Alice served two terms initially. She served 8 years. A CBO director's term is 4 years.
Okay.
So her term ends, and her successor, Rudy Penner, comes in. By that point, the Senate is now in Republican control. So it's split control of the Congress. And I think to reach agreement on a new CBO director among the congressional leadership, I think they settled on a person with a Republican background, a moderate Republican background. I think Rudy would probably confirm this if you asked him. And he came in to head CBO. But the question arose, well, what's he going to do now? How's he going to change CBO? This is the first new person to take over.
Right.
And I think that the key event here is not maybe such a singular event like with the energy security plan, but the fact that Rudy came in and acknowledged that there is a professional staff here at CBO. There's no need to make any changes. We're not going to have staff turnover. We have a cadre of professional, civil servant-like individuals, all working for the director under the Budget Act, but who, in theory, he could have released, fired, brought in new people. Did not do that because he recognized that would be a disaster for the agency's future. Also, he was at the helm when, you know, Ronald Reagan was president, and there was the big proposal from the Reagan administration was to balance the budget.
Right.
And you may or may not remember our friend Rosie's scenario, which was the optimistic economic assumptions that were used by the administration and others to make assertions about how quickly the budget would be balanced under the president's proposals. And CBO again challenged those assumptions under Rudy, and that was an important sort of test for CBO. So I think going forward, it made it easier for future directors to hold firm when they were under pressure or questions were raised about how CBO would do its analysis. So those
and
are
I,
important
I think
seminal events.
Even today, is CBO not considered one of the most trusted agencies? Congress itself, of course, gets low ratings, but I think CBO ranks pretty high in terms of trust.
I think so. And I know that we CBO often hears from people on the outside thanking CBO for standing firm. Mm-hmm. We also get a fair number of people who, you know, don't feel that way because they have they support one side or the other.
Right.
That's fine. That's fair.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's right. I think that is right. So so it was, you know, Alice is the one who really established this institutional culture,
mm-hmm.
this institutional culture of independence, and which was critical for CBO going forward. So what I'd like to do is to turn to briefly just sort of the major duties, the major things CBO does. I won't go into a lot of detail because we can have some questions. And then maybe make some observations about its key features, and then we'll go forward to talk about some current issues.
Well, good. So I'm going to interrupt you for 1 minute just to make clear to everyone that if you are watching live, we do want to take your questions. You can type them into the chat window under this webinar screen, and we will monitor them and take as many of them as we can.
So CBO's principal job under the Budget Act is to support the budget process. And first and foremost, to support the budget committees as they develop a budget resolution and attempt to enforce it. To try to carry out that responsibility, CBO does three basic things. So CBO has a series of annual reports that are released. I almost said released each year, which is redundant. So the big one, the sort of the signature report, is CBO's annual budget and economic outlook, which is released in January, February of each year, right at the beginning, just before the beginning of the budget process, is updated twice a year, once in March in advance of the Congress's action on the budget resolution, and then updated again with a new economic forecast in the summer. In fact, the most recent one was just issued last month with updated economic projections and updated budget projections. So this report provides CBO's projection of spending, revenues, deficits and debt for the next 10 years, which is the current budget window that's used in the budget process, assuming that current laws generally remain unchanged. And that's the key point, because this report, often, you know, anybody who makes projections is going to be criticized because the projections never come, you know, to fruition. But it's not a prediction. It's a projection based on current law. It's meant to serve as a neutral benchmark, a starting point for the budget committees in the Congress to use to measure any proposed policy changes. So that's why it's important, and under the Budget Act, it states that this baseline is to be done essentially according to the requirements of current law, assuming no changes in current law.
Okay. So that is very important, right? Because some of the other projections that you see may be based on what members anticipate changing, or the president, based on what he intends to changes he intends to propose.
Exactly.
But your projections are all based on everything staying the way it is right now.
It's sort of the distinction between doing a current law projection versus a current policy projection, or a policy projection. Actually, to be helpful in this report, we include some alternatives to the baseline that assume that certain spending categories may proceed differently from the baseline based on, you know, either what we've seen in recent years, or just to give lawmakers a sense of how budget trends may occur under different paths. But the fundamental, you know, purpose of the report is to set this baseline for the members.
Okay.
So in addition to this annual baseline report, which is updated twice a year, CBO also does a separate analysis of the president's budget. Essentially, the president's budget is submitted typically in February, early February. Under the president's own set of assumptions, policies, economic forecasts, what have you, to give Congress a consistent basis upon which to judge those policies and their costs compared to the CBO baseline. CBO reestimates those proposals using CBO's latest baseline assumptions, latest economic forecast, and sort of assumptions about how these programs function and its own estimating methods. So this helps the Congress to sort of, you know, again, consider this on a consistent basis with other policy proposals. In addition, since about the past 10 years or so, CBO has been doing a separate macroeconomic so-called dynamic analysis, there's that word,
dynamic
analysis,
okay,
of the president's budget. Mm-hmm. So because the president's budget, it's a large comprehensive budget proposal. Mm-hmm. At about the time I was coming into this, my old job, we had a new director, Doug Holtz-Aiken, who came in at a time when there was a lot of interest, a lot of pressure on the CBO and the staff of the Joint Committee on Taxation, who also do revenue estimates, to do dynamic analysis or dynamic scoring. And Doug realized that this is actually something that could be done if it was done in the right way. And so by that I mean doing it for proposals that were large enough to make a difference, that were large enough to actually have an impact potentially on the economy.
The idea of a dynamic analysis, mm-hmm, is to take a look at the proposal, and you can,
right,
help me here when I mess this,
sure,
up, looking at how it might affect the overall economy and sort of how those changes will...
Right. The size of the labor force. the labor force, the growth rate of the economy, mm-hmm. things of this nature.
Which, so you're only going to do this for proposals that really have the potential to make a macro impact.
Generally, we'll talk more about that in just a second. Okay. So I'm going to get to that, but I just wanted to make the point that this is an example of the kind of thing, a significant policy change, mm-hmm. that it is probably appropriate to do an analysis of its broad economic effects and mm-hmm. how those effects may feed back into the budget.
Right.
And this is something that CBO has been doing, as I said, for about 10 years or so. Mm-hmm. So dynamic scoring or analysis is not new to CBO. Right. There have been other cases in which we've done it for major significant policies. Mm-hmm. But it is something that, you know, there are limitations to it. So this analysis of the president's budget also serves as a sort of a basis for Congress to sort of make budget decisions as it's doing its budget resolution. Mm-hmm. The third report is a sort of a set of budget options. And we used to do this on an annual basis. Now it's sort of done every other year. So I've referred to it as annual, but it could go back and forth between annual or biennial. But the point of the report is to set forth a series of options that on the spending and revenue side that lawmakers may wish to consider as they consider broad policies for the budget. And the focus has been on proposals options. It's a word they don't use at CBO. I've only been gone 2 months and already I've used the wrong word. So to have a series of options that policymakers to look at as they consider broad budget resolution, as they consider potentially broad plans to reduce the deficit. Again, the focus has been on deficit reduction for these volumes over the years. But it is a volume that, again, is not a set of recommendations. Mm-hmm. CBO doesn't make recommendations, but they try to explore a wide range of options mm-hmm. On the spending side, on the tax side, that will give lawmakers a sense of the budget effects of different approaches. It's not comprehensive, it's not exhaustive, but it's illustrative. So that's an attempt to sort of set the table for members for the budget committees in the Congress as they pull together the budget plan and consider big comprehensive budget issues. So those are the big reports that are done to support the budget process. Secondly, on top of that, the second big thing CBO does to support the budget process is cost estimates. CBO is required to prepare a cost estimate of every bill that's reported from a congressional committee. This is a requirement under the Budget Act.
Every bill?
Every bill that's reported from a congressional committee has a CBO cost estimate. That usually numbers a few hundred a year. I mean, it ebbs and flows with the pace of committee activity. But these cost estimates are done, they're point estimates, an annual basis, typically for the period of time that's covered by the budget resolution or our baseline, which is 10 years. And These estimates are very important because typically they'll also include, the formal estimates will include a write-up of how the legislation would work, explains the provisions. And it can form an important part of sort of the legislative process and the legislative history of Congress's action on these various proposals. Because members are getting all sorts of information from think tanks, from the administration, from folks who may have a particular point of view. And this is like one of the single things that describes how the legislation will work. From a nonpartisan perspective.
And at what point do those reports, those estimates,
right.
become public?
That's a great question. So they become public. When we do a cost estimate, a formal cost estimate, it's public and it's on the website. As long as the proposal itself, the legislation itself we're evaluating, is public. So whenever we're evaluating a public proposal, committee reported bill, what have you,
right.
when we finish that estimate, it's public right away. It goes on our website. There are, we also do a great deal of work on a confidential basis for members and committees on draft legislation that they're working on that's not yet public. They're trying to pull together their ideas. They want to get a sense of the budget effects of the legislation, and we'll go back and forth with them. We call it iterating, back and forth with
sure.
them. As they try to figure out what policies they want to set forth in their proposals. And then also, you know, a key consideration in the budget process is what it's going to cost. So those are confidential, but it's a little tricky because we have to, you know, CBO has to make sure that its estimates are available, of public proposals are available to everyone at the same time. And sometimes as something is getting close to being public or getting close to being released, CBO has to be very careful to make sure that its analysis of that version of that public proposal is going to be ready to go as soon as possible, as soon as that public proposal is made available.
How much concern is there at CBO about leaks from congressional committees or member offices before something is public?
You know, I think it's just, number one, it doesn't, in my experience, it hasn't happened that often. I think that, CBO understands that, the legislative process, remember the highly partisan, people are positioning themselves. Perhaps on occasion something may find its way out the door. If that's the case, then that's the case. What we do is we take a look at it and say, if something finds its way out the door, then the proposal itself is now public. So now what we do is we make sure that particular estimate or analysis, whatever it may be, is now available to everyone.
Okay.
So we keep an eye on that and we try to make sure that doesn't happen. But the legislative process is rough and tumble.
It is Congress.
So those cost estimates are critical to the legislative process, and again serve as a foundation for legislative history. I think it's also important for me to note that we're not the only entity working for Congress that does cost estimates.
Mm-hmm.
We do the cost estimates on the spending side and a handful of estimates of certain revenue measures. But the bulk of the revenue legislation, the stuff that affects the Internal Revenue Code, is actually estimated by the staff of the Joint Committee on Taxation, also a nonpartisan staff that works principally for the Ways and Means and Finance Committees. Actually existed before CBO ever came into existence. And we work closely with those guys to incorporate their estimates into ours. And also in case there's any overlap in the estimates that we're doing with them, particularly in health reform is a good example where we were working closely with them.
Mm-hmm.
Because there were tax provisions, changes in the tax code that also affected premiums for individuals and that had all sorts of interactions with the spending side of the budget that we had to work closely with them on. And so they're a key part of this. But CBO is required to produce these estimates of reported bills. And if there is a revenue component, we'll incorporate JCT's estimate into that overall estimate.
Right.
It's also important to note, if I may, that these formal cost estimates are just the tip of the iceberg for cost estimates, as it turns out. CBO is asked, I mentioned the working with members and committees in the draft stage.
Mm-hmm.
CBO is asked to do estimates of bills at other stages of the legislative process, like a House-passed version or a Senate-passed version. Or just members may come at CBO for requests for all sorts of estimates of different proposals. And it's also the question of amendments on the floor of the Senate or the House. These are also important stages of the legislative process, not really contemplated by the Budget Act. So while CBO technically is not required to do estimates at those different stages, it does. CBO is trying to be helpful and working for the committees and the leadership and trying to provide as much information as possible. That has sort of ballooned in recent years. There are literally thousands of informal estimates that may take the form of a quick spreadsheet, an email even, or even a phone call. Those don't get, they may not have a formal write-up associated with them, but to the extent there's like a public table, a table of a public bill that's going forward in the process, we'll make sure that table's put on the website with as much explanation as we have, as CBO has time to do. So that there's a heavy, heavy load of cost estimates. Yes.
Can I stop you for a minute?
Sure.
This is a very good question has come in. What, if any, relationship does CBO have with GAO? And does GAO, Government Accountability Office,
right,
use your estimates and vice versa?
You know, there's not, CBO has great relations with GAO. I worked with folks over there all the time. The key thing, one of the key issues we dealt with there was that GAO was often put in the position of being asked perhaps to do a cost analysis of something, perhaps when a member or someone wasn't getting the answer that they necessarily wanted.
So this is dad said no, let's go ask mom kind of situation?
In some cases, yes. In other cases, it's just that, the nature of a request may include some cost information that they want. And so when that happens, I have to say GAO is very good about reaching out to CBO to get the information from CBO to talk to us about the cost maybe and to make clear to people that to members that only CBO does cost estimates for the congressional budget process. So there's a lot of back and forth with GAO on that. And on the other side, GAO is a much larger organization. They have the capacity to do, you know, field research. They have so much knowledge about how federal programs are implemented. I mean, one of their key jobs is program evaluation and auditing of federal programs. And so they have tons of information that our analysts use to prepare all cost estimates for legislation that might be changing those programs. So there's a lot of interaction between the two agencies. But careful to make sure we, you know, make a clear distinction between the two agencies' duties. And the same with CRS as well, the third congressional support agency. We have maybe less interaction with CRS, but they also do
CRS
congressional Research Service.
Research Service.
Part of the Library of Congress. So we have, you know, great working relationships with those guys.
Okay.
So the last thing I wanted to mention in the category of sort of CBO's, you know, work portfolio, mm-hmm. is that in addition to its legislative support of the routine budget process through these annual reports and these cost estimates, CBO does a third thing. It does analytical studies of longer-term studies of broader budgetary or economic issues that may be related to what's going on currently in the legislative process, or maybe something that involves planning for a later stage or later congressional action on legislative activity.
Example?
So examples would be, a prominent one in my mind involves the minimum wage. So CBO did an analysis of the economic and distributional effects of an increase in the minimum wage. This was not a cost estimate. It was not something that was done, again, not a cost estimate for a particular bill, but a broader analysis of the issues associated with a minimum wage. How many jobs would be lost? How many jobs would be affected? How would family incomes go up or down? Things like this.
Right.
The CBO does an analysis of the long-term budget outlook beyond the 10-year budget window, beyond the 10-year report that's done every year. Mm-hmm. For the budget process. Analyses of defense plans, analyses of transportation issues, analyses of climate change issues, energy issues, analyses of health insurance markets, things of this nature. So just broader studies. And these things typically are requested by committees. There will be the chair or ranking member of a committee will request an analysis, typically to feed into some issue that they want to look at in a longer term fashion.
Have you ever had a situation where someone has tried to kill a report that has been requested by one committee, just prevent its publication?
In my experience, that hasn't happened. I think that we have. It's often once, you know, these requests are confidential until the analysis is ready. But often the committees will sort of inform their counterparts on the other side. And then as we get closer, we'll inform other folks that it's coming. And there may be concerns expressed about the nature of the analysis, about even doing the analysis, and is this appropriate for you all to do? And we'll deal with those. And what we try to do is just to make sure it's well explained, that the basis of the analysis is clear, and that we make sure that folks have exhausted all their questions, that they make sure that they're heard. It still may not, you know, salve all the wounds of a particular analysis that comes out, but we try at least to make sure that folks are informed.
Okay.
So with that knowledge of CBO's duties and responsibilities, I just have a few sort of observations generally about CBO and sort of the key things to think about, the key characteristics and key features of CBO and how it goes about its business. So the first thing we've discussed a little bit is CBO's independence. It really can't emphasize this enough. CBO, there were several models considered as possible options for CBO when the Budget Act was being debated.
Right.
It could be made part of the budget committees. It could be a sort of an operation that serves principally one house or the other. It could be folded into one of the existing support agencies, but I think that there was a sense that the budget and economic analysis was different enough, and the new budget process was, you know, needed this separate support, that it was important to have CBO as an independent entity. But again, the challenge which Alice Rivlin faced right off the bat, and which succeeding directors also face, is to keep that arm's length distance from the important clients on the Hill. Because, you know, in the end, Congress is a partisan institution. It's supposed to be. That's the way it works. It's supposed to represent interests. of constituents. And in the end, the agenda is important. And so they want folks to line up with that agenda. So making sure that CBO keeps an arm's length from that, but is supportive of that, is really a very, very key feature and a key quality of CBO's role. On top of that, and related to that, is CBO's nonpartisan role, CBO's nonpartisanship. This is really linked to its independence, because if CBO is ever viewed as sort of leaning in one direction or the other, it would threaten CBO's independence. It really starts with the director. I mean, the director under the Budget Act is required to be selected without regard to political affiliation. And the director is to select the staff on the same basis. So this is sort of ingrained in CBO. And I remember at CBO, we always would say that if we're making both sides angry equally, then we're doing our job. And that trust me, that was often the case. I often, when I was getting calls from one side or the other, I often wanted to say, I wish you could hear the conversations I'm having with your counterparts on the other side. Trust me, we're not lining up with one side or another. But this issue often comes up in the context of an appointment of a new director. Directors are set for 4-year terms. Right. And the process calls for the budget committees to make to vet candidates and to make recommendations to the congressional leadership. Because formally, the CBO director is appointed by the Speaker of the House and President Pro Tem of the Senate by letter of appointment, but upon recommendation of the budget committees. And realistically, you know, leadership certainly weighs in. But this is the process. And every year, you know, especially if one party or the other is in control, every time this comes around, there's concerns about whether they're going to bring someone in who's going to change the direction of CBO. I mean, we had that in the most recent appointment. That was an issue. You may have remembered the press articles. That was an issue of concern for folks. And again, yet again, as it has in every past circumstance, it's not an issue. It's not an issue.
So Alice served two terms.
She served two terms.
Has anyone else served two terms?
Not two full terms. There have been others who've served more than one term. Mm-hmm. So Bob Reischauer served, I think, he served two terms, but they weren't a full 8 years.
Okay. Is 8 years the maximum?
There's no maximum.
There is no
maximum.
In
theory, there's no term limit for CBO directors, but there's maybe internal term limits about how much you can stand, how much of it you can take.
Right.
So two has been the most. Most recent director, prior to Keith Hall, the current director, Doug Elmendorf, served part of one term. He succeeded Peter Orszag, who left his term early. And then he had a term of his own. So mm-hmm. he had about a little over 6 years
right.
on the job. So,
right.
But when the directorship comes up for consideration, that's typically you'll see concern. This time the concern was, again, the issue of dynamic scoring was a key issue. And would someone come in to sort of take the agency down a path, even though it's done dynamic analysis, that it's never gone and sort of favor one sort of policies versus another set of policies. And the new director, Keith Hall, came in, and one of the first things he said, this is CBO is doing a fine job of dynamic analysis, and our job is to sort of represent the consensus of economic thought, mm-hmm. which has been sort of the basis of CBO directors past. To Congress's credit, I think it's always been the case that throughout all the selections of CBO directors, they have always selected mainstream economists, folks who sort of represent the broad mainstream of economic thought, and never brought in somebody who's taken CBO down one path or another.
Right. Are there key times at CBO where basically nobody's allowed to schedule a vacation?
End of
the fiscal year, when the president's budget is coming out, anything like that?
You know, the analysts there know when, you know, they're sort of in tune with the rhythm of the Hill.
Mm-hmm.
So we're a Hill support agency. We're in tune with that rhythm. Right. So there are key times when August just concluded. A lot of people will take off August.
Uh-huh.
There are other congressional recesses where there may be time to take off. I think, I don't think anyone is ever told, no, you can't have that time off. Personally, I will say at CBO, individuals' personal lives are very important, very high priority for directors and for the managers there. But the analysts there know when they need to be there. More often is the case is when they have to be away, they're still on duty. They may be away on a family trip they couldn't avoid, but they're still available. Mm-hmm. I've talked to people who were off visiting family. They were at a wedding. They had to pull out of the wedding to come talk to me. I've had situations like that. I've been in that position. But you just know, you know.
So what about times like now? Budget negotiations are sort of hot and heavy. You may have deadlines coming up. Changes are coming, potential proposed changes coming down the pike very quickly. Are CBO employees sort of sleeping in their offices at that point? Are you working 24/7? Is it like a journalist preparing for a hurricane?
It can be. I mean, it definitely can be. There are folks, if they're not in their offices, because, you know, technology now, folks can work remotely. But folks, and if folks are often on duty at all hours. They may be at the office. If there's an estimate that needs to be prepared physically to get out the door, then the folks will be there until the time has come for it to be done. That's, you know, whatever is required to get the work done. That is, and in cases like this, there are, you know, people on call. There often what will happen is, especially for the folks who do the cost estimates, you know, managers will set up a way to get in touch with people, or will be the key point of contact. Often what happens is when things like this are happening, when it's in a situation like now, and there's a lot of churning and a lot of important deadlines coming up, then we will work with CBO. We'll work with the leadership, with two chambers, wherever the legislation happens to be, and make sure that, you know, the key folks know who to contact at CBO to get their questions answered, to get their estimates done. So
right now, we're looking at a possible shutdown of the government. Does that involve CBO? Does anybody come to you and say, what will it cost if we shut down the government?
Well, we don't. We may have been asked, what does it cost to shut down the government? That's really actually a question more appropriate for GAO, because they have more of a sense of all of the administrative activities, how they would change. They've actually done a lot of good work there on the broader costs of government shutdowns for federal agencies. But CBO will have to be there to estimate the cost of legislation to end the shutdown, to estimate temporary appropriations or whatever legislation comes along dealing with it. CBO will have to be there to prepare the cost estimates. CBO is an agency like any other. CBO gets an appropriation, a legislative branch appropriations bill. So if there's a shutdown, CBO will be affected like anyone else. And so CBO as an agency has to make a decision about who's essential to the activities of the Congress at that given moment. In the last shutdown, I guess a couple of years ago, we faced that, and there were just a handful of folks. They were the decision was made that they were considering anything that was not related to the consideration of the appropriations to fund federal activities. Was going to be shut down. So all their activity on reports, other cost estimates, anything of that nature not related to that particular issue, folks were not there. There were a lot of there was empty hallways at that time. I was there because I was the person designated to take all the calls from Congress that were coming in to make sure that the calls that came in got to the folks who were the scorekeepers or to the key managers who were on duty at that time.
So can we talk about computing power a little bit? We just have a couple minutes left. But obviously, in order to create these models, you need a lot of computing power. You've got a lot of variables coming in. So does CBO get all the new toys, best computers?
Yeah, there is tremendous computing capacity at CBO. I think that, you know, there's always a desire to have more. I know that... you know, like any, like all other federal agencies, there's been a recent period of diminished resources. You know, we've had with recent budget agreements, caps on discretionary spending have been set, which have constrained resources for everyone. And so CBO had to make decisions about the priorities for spending. And in some years, to make sure that maintained key staff, they diminished spending on technology. That since has been caught up. So I think CBO feels like it's in pretty good shape on its computing capacity. I know that there are things like, you know, we have very sophisticated modeling of the economy. We have one thing in particular is that we have sophisticated modeling of long-term budget trends and sophisticated modeling of the healthcare industry. CBO has the capacity to run health insurance simulations to understand how different groups of recipients of health benefits will behave under different scenarios. And this requires massive computing capacity. So yes, that is a key part because it's not a big agency, as I mentioned, and there are not a lot of people.
Right.
So we also, you know, we get a lot of data. We get a lot of data from outside groups, from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. One thing to mention is that, you know, I've drawn this sort of juxtaposition between the executive branch and CBO, and that is the case. We have different responsibilities, but mm-hmm. our folks do maintain really good relationships with people in the executive branch, particularly the folks who are on the ground sort of running federal programs mm-hmm. that provide information about how these programs work so that we can do a better job of doing estimates of the cost of legislation to change them. So we do make use of lots of outside information. It's ultimately CBO's judgment, but we make use of a lot of information like that and a lot of outside experts, particularly in our analyses, our broader studies. We have an external review process. We have outside folks take a look. So are we on the right path, or is there anything we're missing? Things of this nature.
If I'm a journalist, mm-hmm. what is the best way for me to interact with CBO?
You know, we have, and I hope she doesn't mention me mentioning her name, but we have a fabulous communications director. There I am, we again, because I'm still, you know, sort of joined to the hip with CBO. But Deborah Kilroe, it's on the website. Mm-hmm. Our contact information is CBO's communications director. And I think the best advice for analysts, or for journalists, as they seek to get information from CBO is to contact Deborah, either by email or on her phone number. And also, you know, because what will happen is that if they're looking for quotes or, you know, a response to something that they can put down for the record, typically CBO is not going to do that. CBO does its analysis. It puts it out there. It's well explained. If it needs to be explained further, happy to talk to you off the record mm-hmm. to sort of enhance your understanding if you're a journalist.
So you're happy to give background?
Happy to give background.
For journalists.
Happy to give background, and that happens all the time.
Okay.
Only the director typically speaks for CBO in testimonies and sessions like this.
Right.
And again, of course, I meant to say this up front. I'm not speaking for CBO. These are just my thoughts and observations.
We did introduce you as being retired.
Yes, thank you so much.
So we appreciate that. Thank you so much. Sandy Davis, former Associate Director for Legislative Affairs at CBO.
Thank you, Linda.
Really appreciate your being here.
My pleasure.
And thanks to all of you for joining us here in the Evelyn Y. Davis Studios at the National Press Foundation, where we are making good journalists better. Thank you, sir.
My pleasure.